Welcome, everyone. Welcome to this IEECP lunch seminar. Today, we will hear from Ivana Rogulj, who is the project coordinator of DEESME and DEESME 2050. She will speak about some energy efficiency projects in SMEs. So, Ivana, the floor is yours.
Thank you, Axel. Just a second, let me share the presentation. I hope you can see it. Okay, thanks a lot. So, good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to the lunch webinar. The topic of today is energy efficiency projects for small and medium enterprises. In general, I only have 15 minutes, so just give you an overview of what could be done in small and medium enterprises and why. And at the end, you will see some contacts from our projects that are dealing with small and medium enterprises, and you can see more information there, or you can contact us directly and check if you want to know something more about the specific activities we are working on. So let's start from a thing that's rather familiar to all of us, but a good introduction to what is done in small and medium enterprises. And this is the barriers that they are facing when trying to implement energy efficiency projects. So first of all, it's lack of awareness of energy efficiency project possibilities. It sounds a bit like they're not aware of the fact that they could implement it, but of course that's not true. There is a more of a lack of being aware how useful these projects could be for a specific company if the energy efficiency and energy expenditure is not their top priority. So if they are dealing with the sectors that are not very energy intensive, or if they don't have a personnel that's dealing with energy specifically. The other problem is low capital and difficulty to access financing. This is very specific for small and medium enterprises because not only that they lack their own capital to invest, but they also lack de-risking opportunities to be attractive to financial institutions. So they will invest their capital in the small and medium enterprise projects. Meaning with this, very helpful solutions are standards that are dealing with the external impacts of energy efficiency in enterprises, and they are enabling the de-risking of the projects and investments in small and medium enterprise. And two more barriers include lack of technical human resources. Of course, if there is a smaller, even micro company dealing with this sector that's not very energy intensive, they don't have a person that's working on the technical issues at all. So this is kind of linked to lack of awareness and knowledge on the topic. And last, but very important one, a prioritization. So if there is a kind of a doubt around saving potential, of course, this will not be a company's priority. In a way, this is as a consequence of the bad energy related situation in Europe, this is becoming less and less a barrier because companies are finding energy expenditure as one of their priorities in the last year. So when we look at it from the perspective of the company, there's a list of problems that they are dealing with, but then we also have national authorities who are supposed to help them reach out to do the energy audits and then implement and update the measures. And from their perspective, these obstacles are seen differently, but they still, of course, exist. So they are trying to create different support mechanisms. They are written here as a challenge, although they're actually an opportunity. But the challenge with the support mechanisms seems to be a lack of, for example, awareness on the possibility or administrative and bureaucratic burden that's coming with the support mechanisms that seems to be a problem for the small and medium enterprises, because they, as said previously, lack capacities internally to do this administrative and monitoring work that's needed to get some kind of financial support. Then there's also a problem that's mentioned in the enterprises. This problem is also relevant for the national authorities. They have lack of available resources. With this, I mean the people who are dealing with the implementation or of audits on the large companies or small or medium enterprises that are obliged to do energy efficiency audits are usually like the same people that are dealing with other energy efficiency projects in the national authorities. So their resources are very scarce. They have to cover multiple different topics. so it could be problematic to reach out to small and medium enterprises. This is also linked to a problem that dealing with small and medium enterprises, energy efficiency is not as efficient to the national authority as is dealing with large enterprises, because most of the companies in Europe are small and medium enterprise, but to reach to every one of them is much harder than to reach, of course, to the large companies who are much more energy intensive. And this, let's say, makes much more sense from the perspective of national authority, because it's more efficient, less work investment in comparison to the possible energy savings. That's why it's very important to use the cooperation with the associations, chambers, and other networks of companies that could be like a stakeholder transitioning this knowledge and help from the national authorities to the companies, and grouping the companies with similar issues dealing with energy efficiency. So national authorities, of course, want to support small and medium enterprises in different ways. These are the results from DEESME evaluation of 10 member states, but it could be very similar to in the other member states in the European Union. These are what the things that national authorities are offering small and medium enterprises as their support mechanisms for audits, implementation, and for energy efficiency measures uptake. So all the countries have some kind of funding mechanisms like loans or grants, either these is European grants or the national financing, or different programs which are private-public partnerships or performance contracts and so on. But on the other hand, as I said, this supposed to be sometimes is a problem to reach a small and medium enterprise due to their lack of capacities to even apply to such loans or grants. 73% of our targeted countries, but in general, most of the countries have some kind of best practices tools. For example, a lot of energy agency, like in Austria, have a dedicated tool website that shows all the possible best practices or case studies in the energy efficiency measures. Then for almost more than half of companies, half of countries have trainings and education available for the energy management system, for the energy managers in the companies, for ISO 50001 implementation, and so on. Almost half of countries have voluntary agreements on energy savings with their companies, and some of them, like for example the Netherlands, have regulatory measures and requirements for energy efficiency project uptakes. 27% of countries in our case have some kind of fiscal incentive, like tax deduction if there is an investment in energy efficiency project. Dealing with all these troubles with national authorities having a problem to reach the companies and small and medium enterprises, the European Commission has started a new pilot initiative named the Covenant of Companies. The goal of Covenant of Companies is to offer technical assistance to small and medium enterprises, and with this meaning to help companies and their supporting entities, the ones that I mentioned, so associations, chambers, and so on, to decarbonize their businesses. This is, of course, the pilot initiative, and companies committing will be eligible to receive different support from the Secretariat. Now, coming to the title of this presentation, and this is the answer to the question why. So not only energy savings are relevant from the perspective of the companies, but also there are other benefits that are external to the energy savings when energy efficiency measures are implemented in industrial production or any other enterprise, including small and medium enterprise. This includes so reduction of, for example, waste, reduction of materials consumption, but also use of more recuperation of the fuels and heat and gas. Of course, there is a reduction in the greenhouse gas emissions, but also other emissions like particulate matters, which is very relevant for the companies, for example. not the least, I think very much important, there are health benefits, which are then also linked to the comfort and morale of the employed people. So that also means more productivity. And this is like a cycle of things that are deriving from the energy efficiency projects. So a bit about what we did in DEESME project. So we've involved 500 companies total, of which 400 are SMEs in the four countries that are targeted countries for the project. And in these countries, these companies are a part of the campaign where they are trying to implement multiple benefits approach in the energy efficiency projects. Of these targeted companies, 50 are our, let's say, main target, because we are unable to reach all the 500 companies directly. These 50 companies are undergoing an energy efficiency audit. Of course, this audit is not the one that is usually done, so the one that it's obliged to the larger companies or by the new EED to the companies with the higher consumption. But this is an audit that's also including the multiple benefits aspect, which I'm going to tell you a bit more later. 25 of these companies are having energy management systems, either meaning by that ISO 50001, either introduced or upgraded if they already have one, with the multiple benefits aspect of it. We are also working, as I said previously, you've seen it from the results, with the 10 national authorities, giving them recommendation and guidelines for the implementation of the national policies. And in 5 of them, we are working more directly, giving them solutions on the specific issues that they have with the energy efficiency problems. In the small and medium enterprises, of course, and in some of the large companies. So what we did until now for the national authorities is a country-specific guideline, which has a general guideline of almost 100 pages of different measures and peer-to-peer learning experiences, so examples for other countries and the ways that these examples could be implemented in our countries. And also, as we did direct cooperation with the national authorities, there is a specific guideline for every of the countries included on their specific problems that they are dealing with, reaching out to small and medium enterprises and to other companies. We are so finalizing the national policy recommendation and the direct support, which I already have mentioned. Of course, as said, we are working directly with the companies, and with that, just a bit about the multiple benefits approach. So the multiple benefits approach is based on business analysis or business canvas model, and it is starting from the point of the canvas model that's generally used, and then it's integrating the multiple benefits approach. So after we start from the management model, we do the energy analysis, energy audit, and from that we derive the multiple benefits coming from the from the energy efficiency projects and giving them back to the business model, so doing a business model advancement. This kind of procedure, this kind of result is detailed in the different trainings that are done with the companies, being basic trainings, just presenting this model, advanced trainings and in practice trainings, which also include audits and EMS, which I mentioned earlier, finishing with the cost benefit analysis and the possible measures that could be implemented. Just a few months ago, we started the continuation of the DEESME project, so it's a bit of an overlap of these two projects, but we are dealing with now with one sector only, so it's a furniture sector and its value chain. All the companies that are dealing either with furniture sector or the production of the products that are then used for the implementation in the furniture sector. And we are also doing something similar in the beginning, so walkthrough audit, seeing in 120 companies, seeing what could be the energy efficiency measures that could be included, and the basic training I mentioned earlier, energy management system in 40 companies, and then for 20 companies, the business model that's also been mentioned, working with the management to integrate the business model. But the novelty in comparison to DEESME is not only the sector, but it's also the start trying to prepare the companies for the uptake of these measures, We start from the analysis of the financial market, so public, EU and private market. And according to the model that has been mentioned, we evaluate multiple benefits and analyze them in the energy audits. And for them, we do the cost-benefit analysis and try to matchmake this with finance. So the idea is to help the companies create a pipeline of projects with the finances also added to it, and to matchmake it, try to make a de-risked kind of proposal for the financial institutions that we previously have analyzed and targeted. Just to mention also that this is not the only project that we are working on dealing with the uptake of energy efficiency measures. Currently, there are several live financed projects that are dealing with a similar topic, but we are using different approaches. So this cooperation between different approaches will result in the best uptake of the measures. There is also one additional project that we are partnering, and it's audit to measure, and they are developing the specific methodology of the uptake of measures based on two ideas of the tools. One of them are informational tools, having different information to giving different information to the companies on the results and uptake of the audits. And the others are more of a technical tools and economic and behavioral tools, also giving them the support in implementation of the energy saving measures. Of course, they are resulting with the guidelines that are and recommendations that are to be replicated after the project is finished. So that's it from me, just a short overview on what we are doing. But of course, if you see the overview, there is a lot of things that are behind it, a lot of materials in the developments of the methodology for DEESME, a lot of materials in the developments of methodology for DEESME 2050, of course, for the other projects we are working on also. And the multiple benefits analysis and the cost-benefit analysis, everything, all of this information is available either on our website, or you can use the contacts that are mentioned here to ask us if you need more information. If you have any questions, let me know. Thank you.
Axel, do you ask the questions that are in the chat, or should I? You have two questions there, Ivana. Mm-hmm. From Jean-Sébastien, you mentioned that higher energy prices have increased the interest of SMEs in reducing their energy costs, but we see in several countries crisis measures to help SMEs and more generally companies with energy tariffs, for instance, reducing taxes on energy. Did you also see the reinforcement of the development of new energy efficiency schemes to help SMEs in this context? Is the first one, and then I will ask you the second.
What is my opinion on the topic, but I can say, tell you from the experience of the contact with the companies that we had in the last year. So there was a lot of issues approaching companies in the period when energy consumption was lower due to COVID and the lack of production, but also due to other problems in reaching out and connecting to companies due to the COVID situation. But then when the energy crisis started and the implementation of measures was not yet successful from the side of the countries, the interest rose. So we've seen in our partner pilot countries that companies started contacting our partners to reach out to them and to assist them with the energy efficiency project. What is also relevant, I think, for the SMEs in comparison to the old energy efficiency directive, in the new one, there is no obligation for the large companies also, but also there is a threshold for the small and medium enterprises. So if they have a higher energy consumption, they now are obliged to do the energy audit. And some countries are also introducing energy efficiency measures uptake obligation after the audit. So there is more interest due to that also. So I think the interest in general is rising, no matter the measures that are helping companies at the moment. So they are aware that this is a temporary situation.
Thanks a lot, Ivana. The second question was if you think that ESCOs could be some kind of aggregators of SMEs having the same profile. Having the same profile,
For sure. So what I mentioned, and this happens to all the countries, in all the countries, is this reach out to companies is needed, like through association, through a network, through anyone who is able to contact the companies and take out this burden from the national authority due to the number of companies and due to capacities of the national authority. ESCOs are one of the, I think, better solutions because they have the interest. So they are the ones that could invest and get a profit from the energy efficiency measures. So it's a benefit for both the companies and the ESCO, and still they have the direct capacity to do the energy management system implementation, to do the energy efficiency investment in the company, to finance it, of course, as being an ESCO. And to help the implementation of the policies at the end. So I think this is, of course, the good aggregator for the companies.
Thank you. Are there any other questions for Ivana? Yeah, Jean-Sébastien, go ahead, and then Jeremy.
No, Jeremy first, because I already had two questions.
You're so kind. Thank you. Can you hear me?
Mm-hmm.
Yes. Yes. Hi, Ivana. I had a couple projects on energy efficiency in companies and in the public authorities, and I also follow the European debates on energy efficiency lawmaking. And usually companies find a reason against, let's say, investing in energy efficiency because it hinders their competitiveness. And I was curious to know how in the project you dealt with this issue, and if it were more related to one size of company in particular, or if all of them mentioned it, or if they didn't. This is more or less my question. Thank you.
I don't know if it was clear, but our first evaluation of the status of the companies did result with that it's not a priority. It's not a thing for many companies. Energy efficiency is not a thing dealing with, as you said, it's not changing their position in the market. Energy might not be their priority from the perspective of the expenditure. So there was a lack of interest for many sectors that are not very energy intensive. But then that's why we try to use this multiple benefits approach. And that's why also the Covenant of Companies is trying to find a marketing or competition kind of solution to motivate the companies. So we are trying to integrate what is the result of the energy efficiency into what it could be the result that's beneficial for the market. So that is the solution that we try to find. But the problem is, as you have identified it, the same. And that is also why the Covenant of Companies is doing something like the Covenant of Mayors, so making companies pledge and giving them a kind of a badge, which is good for the competitive part of the company, but also for the marketing. So I think it's a solution that we know for now, but we'll still try to do more during life. There's no 2050 implementation. And Jean-Sébastien.
Yes, very, very quick one. That's a bit of follow-up about the point on the ESCOs. Just to know if in the project it became an issue, the uncertainty on energy prices, because we've seen this huge increase last year. Now it's decreased, it remains high, but it tends to decrease. So, of course, companies that consume energy are happy if the energy prices are decreasing, but then for ESCOs, it may change their business case. So is it something that you address in DEESME or DEESME 2050?
That is something that we will address directly in DEESME 2050. because now we kind of ended up with suggesting the measures and integrating them into as a multiple benefits, but the financial part is only the cost-benefit analysis. So now we are in DEESME 2050, we are dealing with the financial institutions. So as you said, it is a risk not only for ESCO, but anyone who is doing the investment to do it in this in such kind of times. So I might give you a better answer in a year when we will have everything finished from that part. But I can just guess that for sure that will be one of the things that we are dealing with. And also, we are trying to cooperate with ISO and with our advisory board has ISO members because they notice the issue also on a level of the world, not only the European Union, that this perspective of financial institution is that investing in small and medium enterprise is generally risky, and plus this, the investment itself in these circumstances is risky. So they are trying to develop the standard that is linked to the risking of financial investment in a small and medium enterprise. So I think we are moving towards that, but I cannot give you, unfortunately, more information at this point.
Thanks a lot, Ivana.
Thank you.
I think then we can call it a day and thank you again for the great presentation. It will be uploaded on our YouTube channel and shared on all our social media channels as well, anyway, to catch up or to share it if you found it interesting. Thanks to all the participants as well, and have a nice afternoon.
Yeah,
bye-bye.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Thank you. Bye-bye. I think